So that's the opening of the Weber Clarinet Concertino. And I'm going to tell you a quick story about this, about me in this piece. And it might give you some, you may decide you won't want to watch the rest of it because, well, it'll tell you a little bit about how my approach is to it through this story. So back in 1995, I auditioned for Pierre Boulez and the Ensemble Intercontemporain in Paris. Now this is an ensemble that is known for its interpretations and just expert interpretations of some seriously, seriously modern music. And they had a bass clarinet opening, but mostly bass clarinet. And so I went to this audition in 1995, and I don't remember how many people were there, but there was just on the repertoire list, there's nothing that any of you have probably ever seen before, and nor had I seen before. It was like Michel Jarrel, this and that, and the other thing, all these really, really complex, very difficult French music with tons and tons of notes. And the Weber Concertino for bass clarinet. They wanted to hear the Weber Concertino on bass clarinet. Anyway, I play the audition, I make it into the final three. They can't make a decision about the three of us, so they ask the three of us to come back in 3 months. They gave me notes and said, here, this is what we'd like you to work on. I wrote all of them. I actually still have the notes because I kept them as a souvenir. And they asked the three of us to come back and play the audition again. 3 months later, we meet up, same 12 people in the jury, and Boulez again, and we play the audition again. Needless to say, long story, slightly shorter, I did not get the job. And one of the reasons, and probably the primary one, was this. And Boulez let me know at the very end, he had the three of us standing in front of the jury of 12, very, very, it was like being in a courtroom. And Boulez says to them, in French, and then here's the guy who won the job, and then I'm last. And what he says to me in English, he goes, Mr. Lowenstern, I am sorry, but you play with too much character. And I thought, all right, I'm down with that. And the reason I think that I like it with too much character, or even probably more than I even played at that audition, is because Weber, at the time that he wrote this, was an opera composer. Der Freischütz and a bunch of these other, like, just, you know, this is operas, right? Operas. You got big, loud singers on a stage singing to the back of the audience with tons and tons of melodrama, right? So this is the guy who wrote this piece. If it is not full of character, then it is full of boringness. All right, I'll get off my soapbox. Now, so the story of this piece is, okay, Weber had written a bunch of these things, these operas, and he shows up and he meets Heinrich Behrmann. Heinrich Behrmann was the famous clarinet player of his day. Like Stadler was for Mozart, Heinrich was for, I guess, for Weber. And Heinrich Behrmann, if the Behrmann sounds familiar, Heinrich Behrmann is actually Carl Behrmann's dad. Carl Behrmann, who wrote the Behrmann scale book that we all love and hate so much, his dad was who Weber wrote this piece for. And so just think about this for a second. Now, the Mozart concerto that most of you know was written for Stadler, and Stadler had a different clarinet than Heinrich Behrmann did. Stadler's clarinet had fewer keys, okay? It was still in development, right? And so they were making adjustments to it, and they were adding keys, and they were changing a lot about it. So this new model clarinet that Heinrich Behrmann uses has more keys. And because it has more keys, it's able to play chromatically more easily. And because it's able to play chromatically more easily, Weber is going to write a much more chromatic sounding piece. You know, times have changed. It's 21 years later than the Mozart concerto, but this is just a huge leap, as far as I'm concerned, in terms of difficulty and, you know, chromaticism. So there you have it. Back to talking about opera. So when you're looking at this piece, the thing that I just played at the very beginning, the introduction, which we could also maybe call the overture, is super melodramatic. How do you play something melodramatically? Well, ideally, you want to be that fat tenor on the stage singing to the back of the audience with just so much extra drama in it. And that comes with, as far as we're concerned, technically, dynamics, right? If you play piano to mezzo forte in that first crescendo, or worse yet, mezzo piano to mezzo forte, you're not really making a difference to that person in the last row. You need to start every dynamic softer than written, and play to every dynamic long, louder than written, and vice versa. These dynamic changes need to be huge, huge, not these tiny things that are really subtle, because they just don't translate into drama. So here is that first opening played mezzo piano to mezzo forte. It is a crescendo, but it's not enough. You'll hear the difference. So here it is, not dramatically, not enough character, as Boulez might say. Okay, so that's nice, it's pretty, it's nothing. Here we go. Start inaudibly, quiet. Done that better, I think. And then forte is the next thing. So think fortissimo. Big breath. And then to a pianissimo, as quietly as you can make it. Okay, so on and so forth. This is the introduction to this piece. Thank you.